Whenever designing an electronic circuit, there are three main ways to check if it works. Doing the math, highly difficult and time-consuming, not really for lazy people. Building the circuit and checking for smoke, again, not really advised if expensive components are involved. And simulating, using some software made by people who know far more electronics and math than you do. So I decided to make a series of videos about the LTSpice circuit simulator that I currently use. And first thing you need to do, if you want to use the simulator, is get it. So I will just Google it and download the first thing that I find. LTSpice was made initially by Linear Technology, but in the meantime it got bought by Analog Devices. But it's still a free program, and if you go to their website, you need to select the version most appropriate for your operating system, download it, wait a bit, and then you need to install it. Not very complicated. The good thing about LTSpice is that it's a free program, and it's not a 30-day trial free or give me your credit card details and maybe you'll have it for free. No, it's actually a free program. Yes, I agree to this. Perfect. So as I was saying, it doesn't have any hidden features or downloadable content or whatever. What you get with the free installer is what you get. Nothing more. This makes LTSpice a very popular program, and that's very good, since if you have any problems or any questions, you can just Google it. Everybody's using it. It's much more used than other simulation programs like AutoCAD or Saber or whatever. So in this video, we will go through the three main steps of making a simulation. First of all, you will need to make the schematic, choose what type of simulation you want to do, and then run it. And finally, you will need to make some measurements. Get some data out of your simulation, because that's why you made the simulation in the first place. The simulator will not tell you if your circuit is good or is not good. It will just let you make some measurements on it. And it's your job to decide whether the measurements are in accordance or not with what you were expecting. It has been successfully installed, and it's still preparing something. This is gonna take a while. We're only at the first step. There's more. My computer is thinking. It does that. Oh, it's done. It's finally done. So this is the LTSpice 17 program. The previous version was LTSpice 4. It's a very logical upgrade from 4 to 17. So it's a very basic user interface. Very simple. That's what makes it good. So what I decided to do today is make a voltage divider, one of the most simple circuits, and to make some measurements on it. So first things first, we need to make a new schematic. It's automatically named as Draft 1, and we can start to place components. So we have our basic components here on our upper side of the toolbar, and we'll need some resistors. We can place resistors either by clicking them from this menu or by placing the R key, which will also bring up resistors. Next, we need a voltage supply. We will go to the components menu, and here at the end, we have the voltage source. And finally, we need a ground, something that all the voltages in the circuit will be referenced to. So we will put one here and put one here. To connect everything together, we will use the wire tool. And the nice feature is that we can just go directly through components and the program will automatically link the components without having a short circuit over them. So our circuit's done. Or is it? Well, we need some values for the components. Let's say that we want for the voltage source a 10 volt supply. Now to get to this point, I went with my mouse over the component and right click it. Now here I have a little window in which I can type in whatever voltage I want. So we will want a simple 10 volt voltage supply. Next, the resistors. Again, right click on them and add some values. We'll make this one a 10 kilo ohm resistor, so 10k, and the other one 20k. Now our values are also displayed on the schematic. We can add pieces of text. For this, we have in the upper right area the text command, and here we can write whatever. So this is a voltage divider, and it will appear as a blue text. Now, if I want to simulate the circuit, all I have to do is click on the running man. Now, the simulator doesn't know what exactly I want to simulate. I have many types of simulation that I can do. For now, I will just concentrate on the transient type of simulation. In this, we will simulate the circuit for a given amount of time, defined by the stop time parameter. So let's say we want to simulate for 1 second. When do we want to start saving data? Well, instantly, so we do not fill in anything here. And also everything else, we can leave it blank. And we have our command to start the simulation, which also got displayed here on my schematic. After my simulation was done, the measurements window has appeared, in which I have a time scale. So what can we measure? Well, we can measure voltages. If I go with my cursor over various nets, it turns into a probe. I can zoom in and out using my scroll from the mouse. So if I click here, I see that my 10 volt supply is exactly 10 volts. What a shocker. But let's see what my voltage divider does. If I click on it, I see that I get my measurement, which is on net 002 at 6 point something. Not sure exactly what it is. So to have a better zoom in, I can either remove the first measurement, right click and delete this trace, and my scale is still wrong, so I still have no idea what the volt on net number 2 is. So by right clicking on my window, I can click zoom to fit. Now I know that the voltage is around 6.66 something volts. I still don't know exactly how much it is. Now if I click on the title of the measurement, this cursor menu that appeared, I have cursor number 1, which I can move over my graph. So if I click on it and hold click, it moves. And it tells me that at 728.3 milliseconds after the start of the simulation, I have exactly 6.66665 volts. I will just remove it so it doesn't bother us. Okay, we measured the voltage. Next, we can measure the current through our components. If I go with my mouse over the component, it will show me this current probe symbol. If I click it, I get the current through resistor 1, displayed by this green line. And on the right side, I have a scale for current, so in milliamps. Again, clicking on it will bring up the cursor, and I can see that I have 333 microamps going through my circuit. Now, if I don't like the units of the scales, I can change them. Simply going over them, the ruler appears, right click, and now we can edit the axis. Maybe we want it to start from 8 volts. If I click OK, then I will have a new graph starting from 8, going to 6.60 something. I don't like that. I want it to go to 0. And now we have a very nice graph growing from 0 to 8, with a 4 volt in the middle, but nothing else. If we want a better division, we can just select the tick we want. So we want it to go from volt to volt. And now we have a very nice graph going from volt to volt, on which we have voltage in net number 2. Why is it called net number 2? Well, that's the name the simulator automatically gave it. We can change that, of course. We have this label net option, in which we can call the output as output. We bring it here into the circuit, and we can connect it to our previous net number 2. Now if we re-simulate, net number 2 no longer exists, but the net output now appeared. Next thing we can do, we can edit our traces. Simply right click on it, and the first thing that we can do is change the color. For example, maybe you want it pink, you don't like blue. Maybe this is your favorite color, I'm not the one to judge. Other things that you can change, the expression you are showing. For example, at the moment we are showing our output voltage. Maybe we want to know what the double of this is. So we can simply write here times 2. This way, instead of 6 volts, now we get 13. Next, we can make operations between multiple values here. For example, we know that the output of our power supply is called node number 001. So now to this output voltage, we can also add the voltage in node 001. We should get 23 volts, and we do. Another thing that we can also plot out is the power dissipated over our resistors. For this, we go over our resistors and press the Alt key, and this thermometer appears. If we click on the resistor now, we have the power dissipated over resistor 1, which is the difference between the voltage on node 001 and on node output times the current going through resistor 1. Let's just remove all these since these are no longer required. Let's also zoom to fit. And now we can see that we have about 1.1 milliwatts dissipated on our resistor number 1. This is especially useful when we want to measure the dissipated power on more complicated circuits, for example, a transistor or an op amp or some other circuit. The simulator will automatically generate this formula necessary to calculate the power dissipated. Also, we can measure the power on our power supply, know exactly how much power is needed for our circuit. Again, if we have multiple traces displayed and we only want one of these traces, we can just double click on the measurement we want. So for example, if I want the current through error 1, I can double click it, and then everything else disappears and only this trace will remain. Now, if I want to measure the difference between two points, I can either write the formula as previously shown, so measure the voltage through the first node, measure the voltage in the second node, and then just subtract one from the other. Or I can simply go with my voltage measurement over the first node, hold and click, press the control key, and then just go to another net with which I want to make a difference. So I automatically made the difference between the node output and node 001. Since node 001 is at a higher voltage than the first node, we get a negative voltage. Another thing we can try is to add an extra component, for example a capacitor. If I simply put a capacitor here in parallel with my resistor, normally nothing should happen. Since this is a DC circuit, the capacitor should not have any influence. Let's just put it at 10 nanofarads. If we simulate it, our output voltage remains the same. No change, the capacitor has no influence on our circuit. But let's make it have one. So if we go into our simulate menu, we go into the simulate dropdown and we edit the simulation command. And we have this option to start the external DC supply voltages at 0 volts. What this does is start the power supply not directly at 10 volts, but at 0. And then it will ramp up to 10 volts and our circuit will then function. This is especially useful when simulating oscillators or other things to see how they start up. Now, if we run the simulation, we see that our output voltage didn't start at 6.3 volts, it started at 0, and it slowly ramped up. We can zoom in on parts of our graph by holding click and then zooming onto an area. Now we can see that we have a very nice ramp caused by our capacitor. If we remove the capacitor, I'm using the cut tool. Just disconnect it, leave it there, not a problem, and re-simulate. And now I go back into the start of the simulation, I will see that my power supply ramped up from 0 to its final voltage in 20 microseconds without any other influence. When I added the capacitor, it took a few dozen milliseconds to ramp up. So that way we saw the influence of our capacitor. Also, we can change the stop time to, let's say, 10 milliseconds. We don't need to simulate for a whole second, and re-simulate just to have a zoom in on our area of interest. For today, that will be all. Hope you enjoyed this video and you got some useful information out of this. If you want to see more videos like it, please subscribe to my channel and see you next time. Bye bye!